So this is about the CH topology. Give you an idea of what is the goal of this chapter, and maybe also give you some motivation. So, and I have to, so I have to go back to where we were next the last time. So last time I explained the existence of a morphism of T spectra, which as usual goes from the spectrum representing the Ramp cohomology to something which we hope to be useful to study this. And this something is this, I write it down, so obtained by this singular construction of Wolski, stabilization of spectra, some this is applied to the direct image computed locally for the CETA topology around sites, which is applied to the direct image computed a different topology, now it's CH star of something which is suspension spectrum slightly modified. On some complex operations. And this one was on the complex operation on some diagram of Starsky. It's not so important for the moment, I just tell you what you want to do and what we have. So this is something which lives, so this is a morphism. The category of excellent foliation, more precisely on the category of smooth excellent foliation over K. And so the one important thing here is that so the left hand side, sorry, the right hand side. To compute this thing, it only depends on its on the values of y on excellent foliation, and therefore, and these excellent foliation are one could consider them as being somehow not so interesting from the point of view of foliation, but rather trivial. And so, this target is not only depends on trivial foliation. So this is good for us, but it's not. That's still not enough. So and I want to explain why it's still not enough and what we want to do now. So, this is still not good enough. And so I try to explain why it is not good enough and how we can hope to get things better. If you remember, I think my first talk, I explained some argument using Hodge theory. And so the idea is somehow that we want to use this argument and maybe extend it to this object here. So we face the following problem is that, so here is a problem that I would like to solve today and in this lecture. The following is that, so the Ramp cohomology excellent. You can erase them. Like tables that appears here. Has no extra structure like such that weight structure or more precisely touch based on structure. It's actually very easy to write on such foundation where you can show that there is no such structure. Here's an example. A very simple one. If you take U, an open subset of the spectrum of your base field, and you have drawn some system of variables, formal variables, then this is so in general this has so there's a branch homology of such thing has no structure. In general, of course, for instance, for example, the complement of a normal crossing divisors, then you can put something on the common field. I'm speaking about general U, such that the complement of U is not normal crossing divisor, something more complicated. And of course, this is not so precise. By this, I mean you cannot put a structure on this group which would be compatible with the structure, for instance, that you have on algebraic varieties via maps from U to algebraic varieties. And so these kind of groups, they still appeared in this right-hand side. And so somehow the goal of today's lecture is somehow to show that we can get rid of these things. Okay, so and more precisely, so the goal is to explain that if we work locally for the H topology, and in fact more precisely for a variant of this which is introduced today, CH, then this problem is gets solved. This problem. So we can rewrite this thing locally for this topology in a way where we can hope to find some extra structure on the group that appears. So this is somehow informal, and this is the motivation of this chapter. So the chapter will be about mostly about the H topology and some variant of this topology. So I assume some of you maybe have never heard about this thing, H topology. So I try to explain this. And somehow something which will play an important role when dealing with H topology is the notion of evaluation rings. And so I want to start with a paragraph about what this is. This would be. Yeah, so this is something I call polyclad, which is not maybe word, but it comes from the French word trait, which means some kind of a line. And this is to say that you have this kind of image in your head. So this is what, and so this would be so as we can see, this is essentially the spectrum of evaluation rate. So let's start with the definition of this. So for me it will be a probe scheme. So and the structure of the prose structure would be always somehow evident from the context, but that's so it's just a priori to be some kind of pro-object or pro-scheme, such that affine. The fifth range OV is valuation. So I don't know if you know what is a valuation ring, but that okay if I assume this, if you know what valuation ring. Okay, so you would see, I mean, I will be using these valuation rings today, and so in case you have any question, I can try to explain what's going on. So, and whenever we have such a thing, we denote, so I denote by gamma V, this would be the valuation group, right, which is, we can take always to be KD stars, so KD would be the fraction field of OV, modulo OV star. This is an order, so this is a totally ordered group. And so the natural, the obvious map from kappa V. Doing an infinity is called the valuation. So I usually denote this by B index B. So this is the valuation. That's a point three is simply just a spectrum, essentially a valuation. So I think that there is no name for the spectrum of valuation ring. I don't know. If you have a better name, I could use it. So I call this a point.
This is somehow assumed to be representable or not?
Representable, what do you mean?
I mean, it's a pro scheme.
It's
a scheme.
No, it's a pro scheme.
It's a pro scheme, but so
it's
the spectrum of anything. Hmm? It may not be the spectrum of anything.
So it's an affine pro scheme. So it's a pro system in affine schemes.
Okay.
So. And what I'm saying is that if you take the co-limit of the function, you get a valuation ring.
Okay.
That's all.
Okay.
If, for instance, if you have a valuation ring over a field, then you could always you can put on the spectrum the obvious pro structure, which is given. Whenever you have a ring, you can think about the spectrum of this ring as a prose finite type scheme. Right? So, for instance, this would be something that I will do later. So whenever I have a valuation ring, I want to think about the spectrum of this as a pro finite type scheme, for example. But we will see other situation today. So, let me give you maybe some remarks. So, a polytree So it's just a totally open set. I assume that this to be a finite set, which is usually assumed. I mean, this is actually probably wrong to say this. I mean, there's probably, if B has infinite many points, then there's some non-obvious topology. But so I always assume that my B has finitely many points, which is assumed. And in this case, it's really, as I said, it's just a finite totally ordered set. So you have the generic point, then you have a point which is in the closure of the generic point, and so on. Okay, so this is how B looks like.
It's usually not Noetherian.
Sorry?
It's usually not Noetherian.
It is not Noetherian, yeah. It's only nothing if it's a discrete valuation domain. Okay, and here's another remark. So the valuation group can be, as I said, it's a totally ordered. This is a totally ordered group, a Boolean group. And so totally ordered groups, they have two important invariants. So let's take one general one, so just the gamma to be a totally ordered group. Then you can speak about its rational rank. And this is by definition, this is just a dimension of gamma tensor, the vector space gamma tensor. And in all my So it will always have this will be always a finite number. And I mean, of course, it can be infinite, but in all the examples I'm considering today, or over time, it will be finite. And there's also the height of gamma, which is this is a number of so-called of strict isolated. What mean to be isolated? So isolated means that that there are two ways of, to think about this. Either to say that it is the kernel of an increasing map of totally ordered groups, and there is a characterization, which is really internal. Which is the following. So whenever you have an equality like this, and y happens to be in H, so that should be it's the H such a group. So y would be in H. So if y is in H, then necessarily x is in H. This is what it means to be an isolated. So there are these two numbers. And now, if gamma is gamma B, so in the case, then it turns out that the height of gamma is equal to the length, and the length is of course the number of not points but number of points minus one, so the cardinality of B minus one. We want the point to be of height z, of length zero. In fact, one can be a bit more precise here, so that there is a the bijection, so that there exists a bijection. Prime ideals of B and it takes this projection takes h and send it to the set of element POV with the property that the valuation of n is not green. And therefore it's larger than any element. So this is not, it will not really play any role today, but just to give you some idea. So I think I said one extra fact about probably order groups. Also good to know. So for example, it's clear that the height is smaller than the rational. Gamma is open order. So the height of gamma is smaller than 1, if and only if there exists an increasing by subgroup of and then there is so if the gamma is finitely numerated, or finite dimensional vector space is also space. There exist totally ordered group, gamma 1, gamma h, and h will be the height gamma of height 1. That exists in E with a property that X E is Y is X prime E for up to E minus 1, and then X E is strictly smaller than this one. And you see, for instance, in this, you see that the gamma H. So 0, 0 times gamma h, this would be an isolated subgroup of gamma. And so yes, the isolated subgroup of gamma are given by the product from here to here. Okay? All right, so this was Yes, the definition which is the unrelated user. But it's convenient, very convenient. So this would be said to be formally local. Is a point in the following sense. So we ask that the xi of time integral. The map xj xi dominant, and you want to close the four x's. Okay, so this is some kind of natural condition. And so I will use the pro scheme as a point. Okay, so the pro structure on this guy is of course the one induced by construction X. Okay, and I just want to take a closed subscheme in this. Okay, so here's an interesting situation that will come up later. So let's take D, S, an integral as soon as you are given a map from B to S, which is let's find the financial condition. So it is dominant map. And we also ask that the extension is finite degree or has finite transcendence degree. And you also ask that the structure of pro object is the natural one. So I will not write it down, just in case already. So what is the natural one? One is the following. So you can write V as a limit of finite type S key. Okay, this, you can do this all the way, you have a scheme. This is another section, by the way, it is not noetherian. So you can write V as a limit of finitely presented or finitely generated finite type S schemes. But then, since S itself has also a structure of a pro object, any finitely presented S scheme also is essentially uniquely a pro scheme. Okay, and we use this. Okay? is the situation. And so in this situation, we will do the following construction. So we consider factorization like this. Let's call this star, where y is a prime finite representation. And so the situation I denote by sigma y, so the image of sigma. I did not say what is sigma here. So usually, if, let's say, v is a both as e, and by sigma v is both. So take the close point, I map it to y. And so yeah, and then we define v as a hat. This will be the process then, so the flow object limit in the category of flow objects over all possible factorization like this of the completion at sigma. So whenever we are in this situation, we can associate to V a natural row scheme, which is the V hat. And we think about V hat as some kind of completion, if you want, of V at its closed hat. Okay. And it will not make sense maybe to complete V directly because V is not Noetherian. But when we do it like this, it's somehow better behaved because everything here is. This makes sense. So the thing which is important to realize here for the remark is that in this situation, usually this guy, he has, is not and some of this is some sometimes explain what will come up. Okay, so this this motivates the following definition. So let's fix an integer n. So I define what is formally pre-separated polytrace. So I think I try to abbreviate just this by F. Formal dimension. So this is a pro object. Omega. Written as omega I. So it's not only a post-skin, it's actually it's a pro object in the category of post. Such that the following condition two are satisfied. So, as of course, as you imagine, we want this to be evaluation ring. And the other condition is that we want that the Wi's, each Wi to be formally local. And also the important thing is that of good dimension. So we want to bound the dimension. And also, let's say, plus we assume that the map from omega to omega I to be always dominant and local. Which would imply that the maps between WG to the I is also dominant. And I would say that omega is formally saturated. If, moreover, the value group is a two vector space. And the residue field, which I denote by k tilde omega, is algebraic. So this is the residue field. Maybe so if omega is formally pre-saturated and T inside omega closed, Chomsky, then also which is also to know is that if omega is saturated, not only pre-saturated, then in fact the generic then the fraction field is a right. It's not true in general that if your residue field is directly closed and your valuation and your value group is divisible, that this is a direct closed. But in this case, okay. So maybe let me make a link with the previous construction. So that's the situation that I explained earlier. So. So again, omega as before. So for if you fix p, so for fixed p, we let so we let vi to be spectrum of the following thing, so of full W intersected with the algebraic over of kappa I in kappa. So the algebraic closure of this is the subfield of this, and when you intersect with this, you get the evaluation thing, and this is something. And it takes the spectrum of this. And so now we are, as in the previous situation, we have evaluation or a polyplay mapping to formally local Kapowski. And so we can form these completions. And so the easy fact is that the W that we started with is actually isomorphic to the projective limit indicator of Bro, so I write it like this, of these completions. Okay, so, and this is actually a typical thing, so the W that we will construct later will always be obtained as limit like this of completion. So
I'm sorry, also, yes? can you say again what is K dot kappa W tilde?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is a residue field.
Okay. And what is the difference between that one and that one?
And that one? This is a fraction field. Which one?
Like the.
So this is fraction field. Okay. And when I put the tilde down, this is a residue field. I think I will not use this much, but this is used all the time. Kappa of omega, or any so kappa of any integral scheme would be the fraction field. All right, so I want to state two facts without proofs about that will be stated. And it's actually about this, again, this situation that I described before. So, here's the first thing. So, consider the previous situation. Of a map from a polyplay B to a formally local scheme, and assume that. Then the valuation extends in infinity, and it continues. To a pseudo evaluation. V of V hat, which of course goes from O V hat to gamma. Okay, so the pseudo evaluation is the same as evaluation, except you don't ask that the pre-image of infinity to be zero. It might be an idea. Okay, so moreover, we define V tilde to be the subscheme of V hat brought out by the kernel of this evaluation. Formally pre-separated. Pre-separated. Of course, it will be a high one. Okay, so maybe I say it again. So whenever we are in this previous situation, we have a polytree mapping to something formally local, and we perform, we use this construction of this completion V hat. Then, on the function of V hat, we have a pseudo evaluation. It's really particular to the situation where the height is one. If the height is not one, we don't have such. But here we have this pseudo evaluation, and we can kill the element that goes to infinity, and what we get now a true valuation ring when modeled by this idea, and the spectrum of this, which is actually called V tilde, turns out to be formally pre-saturated polytree.
Even tell which are rings and which are schemes.
V is a scheme. OV is a ring. I usually write a scheme modulo an idea to mean the spectrum of the O modulo idea. Okay, this is a scheme. Scheme. Okay. Is it okay?
So you mean the height of gamma V is one?
Can you say again?
You define the height for groups or for a scheme?
Oh, thank you. Okay. So this is the length of V, which is the height of gamma. Okay. So I also state another fact, which is related to that previous proposition, which also will play an important role later. So this is the following proposition. So the same condition as in the previous one. So we have the following situation, maybe the diagram. So we have this completion of E, that maps to E. And so by the previous proposition, we have inside this, we have closed subscheme, which turned out to be, again, a point A, formally separated one. Okay, so we have this situation. And now what we do, we consider a map from T to B hat. So this is, so take a map which is from a point A. Different from the closed point. Okay, so we take a map from a point T to E. So the idea is that we start with something that we consider to be nice, which is a point A. We complete it, but this is not anymore a point A. We try somehow to make it again, if you want, a point A. So we take a map from T to gamma I. And so here we assume that that the generic point is not, here's the closed point, which is actually also the closed point. Okay, so we assume that this map is not constant factoring to this closed point. And then the conclusion is that that the tilde is contained in the image of okay, so this is it's somehow maybe I tell you why this is maybe slightly surprising. So you see, usually if you have maybe just a remark here. So usually if you have a scheme X, a general scheme, maybe if you want general scheme, maybe notarium if you want. And then you map, you take a polytree and you map it to X. Somehow then the image of this map, you cannot say much about it. It's just consisting of point, but you don't know, for instance, the image will be, of course, a chain of points, and this is in the closure of this, and so on. But there might be a big hole between them. And for instance, you can link, this could be of height 1, and map the generic point to the generic point, and the closed point to the closed point. Right? So there would be nothing in the middle. Okay? So here, this is setting something which is somehow different from this general behavior. It's telling us that in the case of this, we cannot miss this single point. So here we have the generic point of this theta. We cannot miss this point. Okay, it will be always in the image. And maybe also a remark in the same direction, which is actually much easier to prove, is the following. So if you have a map between polytree and assume that this map is dominant and local, which means that the generic point is in the image and also the ghost point is in the image, then this map is surjective. Easier than that, it's not super hard, but this is really, that thing is really very easy. So this is something. Now I want to introduce this CH topology. So we have seen, the CH topology and the CH Davis topology, and so this is somehow the same spirit. It's just we take the H topology and we add some other colors. Right, so let me remind you what is the H topology. Start with the official definition, but I'll explain what it means. So a family of maps, of morphisms of schemes, it's called, is an H cover. Universally substituted. So I don't know exactly what means substituted. This is a notion that was introduced by I think David Reed, which is the right one. In the context where you don't have finiteness assumption on your street. We don't really need to know what this means, so I just let me tell you what it means concretely. So concretely there's a definition of this notion, and then there's a theorem which says that it's the same as this condition here, but we don't really need this, just to work on this. What it means. So the concrete meaning is the following. So this means that this cover, or this family, can be defined solution. Quite simple. So if you want to cover X, you just have to give yourself a surjective proper morphism to X, and then take a heuristic cover of the source. So this the H topology was introduced by Wolkowski in his thesis. He was using this in the context of the Noetherian scheme, and then David somehow extended this. But somehow this equivalence also was known to Wolkowski, at least in the Noetherian case. Alright, so this is the H topology, and of course, Mark. So if you have a family, this is an H cover if, as usual, we want the FIs to be basic, and the family we obtain by just writing polynomials is an H cover. In fact, I don't really need this generality here. I introduced the CA topology in this so now define CA topology, and it's really the same definition as for CA tag, for instance. We just replace the tag by H. But I'll do it. Okay, so the CH topology on singular affiliation is generated. Singletons. Consistent with this form. Diffetal basic. Actually, a bit silly to put this here because somehow these are essentially covered by one, except that in one officially we ask for finite representation, but here not. But it's not so important. So what's really important is these two colors. So, as I said before, so in fact, as for CH or strict well restricts to extent prediction. In fact, from now on, we only consider this restriction. Care about this restriction. Okay, so this is a topology that I want to study today. So, okay. Let me make a general remark as well. So I told you what was I told you what was formally known. Rho scheme, and you can imagine what this. I will not define it again. It's the same thing, except that you want your field or this pro scheme XI to be a pro foliation. It's the same condition. And in fact, I want even this to be a pro excellent foliation. Okay, from now on. There's also the notion of from now on, all my polytrail will be somehow also foliated, so that they have a structural foliation, but somehow kind of an obvious one, very close to basic. Again, since I'm only working with these excellent foliations, and so okay. So I might not say it, but when I speak about, for instance, saturated polytrail, it will be naturally an object of excellent foliation. All right, so this is that I can now state the following simple lemma. So I'll maybe make a link between these two paragraphs. So here's So let W be saturated, informally saturated. Wait. In excellent position. Then the functor that sends appreciate or receive to the value on omega is a point that defines the point of the topos of sheaves for CH topology on X. Okay, so these formally integrated. Yeah, they give us points for this for the CH. And this is in fact very easy to prove. One just need to check that every CH power is split. CH cover, there are somehow essentially two kinds of them. One are given by completion, but since this is somehow, by definition, omega is a limit of completed schemes, then this is automatic to split completion. Okay? The next kind of covers are given by this proper selective morphism, but then again, since omega is a polytree and even and the fraction field is directly closed, this is also automatic. Okay? So you need a directly closed generic point somehow to split already. So generic at the next step. And in fact, so we will see, so fact, this actually, this gives conservative family. Okay, so this site has this topos had enough points that are given by this but in fact I will need somehow a slightly more precise version of this fact which will be the next proposition. As I said, it should be considered as a slightly more precise version of the fact there. So we fix an integer, and S, an excellent variation. And we also give ourselves a prop. draw object in the category of pro footage such that for every index A that exists one of these two things, so either a formally local propagation XA, final tag is the basic partition, or to simply an excellent partition or an excellent partition. So either something like this or just simply an partition by A, and such that UA is a pro optimum. By dimension, I really mean the dimension at the limit. So for example, if you write the generic point as the limit of non-empty objects in some integral scheme, this is how the dimension is. And then, so in this situation, we have two facts. I'm really interested in fact A, but fact B, but fact A is maybe nicer, sorry. First, so we take F achieved on this side and I take two sections of F evaluated at the pro scheme. So then, there exists a formally saturated polyfill W of formal dimension smaller than N, a morphism. One restricted to W is different from S2 restricted. Okay, so this is A. So I've got to need some space to say B. Why this is somehow more precise at this factor? I mean, the thing that the extra information that we have is that we can choose our W to have formal dimension less than n. This is somehow the thing that you get more from the statement, and this will be useful for some interactions there.
Okay, so
the second part, which is on the divided version of this, so we take G to be a complex species bounded. I will give a sketch of this proof. It's not maybe very interesting, but at least give you maybe some feeling about how. At least it gives also a construction of this formally related polynomial. So try to give it a quick sketch. So we need to construct. I mean, I only prove A. So we need to construct this. So we have these two sections, and we want to construct on A. So we first establish, if you want, establish the following four properties. U, S1, S2 as intersection. Okay, so I start with a tuple like this, and I prove four properties related to the situation. So property one is the following. So you can find there exists a point in the limit of this cross key, such that if you restrict this one to the completion, it's still different from this two restricted to the completion. Okay, so what does it mean? A point in the limit means it's a system of points in each, let's say, UA, for example, and you complete this UA at this point. Okay, maybe why do we have this? And this is just by induction. So you use look at the square. You've got U minus A. Right, so this is the. This is a least negative square, this in some sense. Or if you want, this and this cover U. Okay? But now you see we are working by induction. So I should have said this before. So I work by induction on N. This N in the proposition. So this has a cross dimension N minus 1. Okay, so I know the result here, so I know that in fact. So yeah, I also maybe work by contradiction. Okay, so by contradiction. So I assume that in fact it's not okay. I work maybe. Yeah, I mean, it's not very. I don't want to make this very precise. So use induction here, and then you see that necessarily the two sections should be different. Okay, this is. Okay, so this is property one. This. Okay. property 2. Again, so we have U as 1 and S2, and so property 2 tell me that you can find V inside U closed integral dominant transition map. Maybe I have to add one of the objects such that this one is just okay, so this is again, it's, roughly speaking, is not so difficult. You can cover U by I mean, if U was just a simple, I mean, it was an Athenian scheme, then you would cover U by the reducible component and take V1 of these. Okay? You have to take to pay some carry because you are dealing with problem, but can be done. So P3 is the following. So here we assume that U is integral. Then P3 tells you the following. You can, so S1 restricted to U bar is different from S2 restricted to U bar, where U bar is the normalization U in kappa U and kappa U. Take the right order of kappa U, fraction, and you take the normalization and you still have it. And again, this is also clear because this is essentially the map from U bar to U is essentially a cover. So here, before, again, it's that. So before that, again, it's for U integral. Let's say that if you restrict S1 to U tilde, it's also different from S2 to U tilde. And here, where U tilde, is the pro object modifications. So what are the modifications of U? This is just the thing that you get by blowing up. Okay. All right. So now we can tell you how we understood. So having this property, we do as follows. So we construct a sequence, a tower, of pro objects like this, where we take U0 to be U. And so we get UR from UR minus 1 by applying P2, and then P3, P4, and then P1 to UR. Okay, so it's a construction by induction. So if I assume that UR minus 1 is constructed, then it has the property that restricting S1 and S2 are still different here. What you do, you apply P2 to make U integral. You apply P3 to make the generic point of U and a bracket closed. You apply P4 to insert this modification. Then you apply P1 to replace this modification by a point and the localized at this point. Okay, and then you repeat this, and somehow the W will be the limit. And it's easy to check that this W satisfies the property set. Okay, so and in fact this is somehow how these formats created for E3 are constructed there. This exactly is the construction. Okay, so now we come to something slightly more interesting, which is the notion of strong rigidity. For example, if you simply take take k over small k as my generic extension, you take r inside k by relation a, and you look at spectra. This is the kind of thing that you want to consider. So this is, of course, highly very far from being Fromian saturated, it's too small, but still you would like to understand the cohomology of this guy first of all. And of course this will not be possible all the time, so you will have to restrict attention to some very special kind of sheaves, and these are called the strongly rigid sheaves. So I'll start with defining what these are. So we say that F is strongly rigid . And so what are these two properties? So the first one is very simple. We want that the value of F at W, so there is a natural map to F at the closed point. We want this to be quasi-epsilon. So this is, you have probably seen the notion of rigidity before. For example, Susin rigidity is very similar to that one. Right? We want that the value of our complex of sheaves at W being the same value possible. This is the first condition. The second one is a more complicated state. Maybe let me take some place. for this second mission. So let the tubing inside W be the open. So this of course only makes sense if we assume that the length of W is not zero. So in this case, so let the tube inside W be the open subset or subscheme of any non-empty open subscheme of W is also a polytree. Yeah? We take the one which has length one, we take the generic point and then the next one. Okay, so this is we ask for the following condition. So then we want that the map from F, the generic point of W, which is also point of U, which is also the generic point of W, we want this, so this map to F generic point of U tilde to be a quasi-isomorphic. And remember what, so this U tilde is this thing that I appeared earlier today, so U tilde, this is, you compute U as a closed point, and you multiply inverse image of this pseudo-evaluation. Okay. So this is the definition of being strongly rigid. And so it might be that it's very hard to check, but in fact it's not so hard to check. I will not check it, but indeed, I mean, at some point you will have to check that some things are digital. I would maybe even sketch the proof, but yeah, it turns out that these conditions are not so hard to check.
If they are true, they are
very special, so
you don't expect them to be true always, but sometimes you can check them. Okay, so.
Yeah, here's a remark, so the notion of a strong rigidity in this environment this is the case, so indeed you see all the proportion that appears in the condition, there are actually points for the for the omega, sigma omega, or eta, and even eta and theta, so these are points. This is a formally saturated polytree, and these are the bracket closed keys. Okay, so the first result about these kind of species is the following theorem. So we take F on solution over S, which is assumed to be bounded from the left and strongly rigid. Then the following is true. So again, let's fix omega formally separated. Then the conclusion is the following. So then, for every U inside W open non-empty, so again, this is so U will be a polytrail, but of course, U will not be formally separated in general. But still, so then for every such U, the obvious. Is morphism from so the cohomology of U F to R gamma CH of the closed point is an isomorphism. Okay, so even though the U is not formally separated, it still behaves like a formally separated polytrail with respect to it. Yeah, we still have this rigidity, somehow properly, in some sense, to all open subset of W. So, I also said another theorem which is actually stronger than this, which is actually the one that we are anticipating. But I would really want to prove this because some of this is the main. But the next term is really more appealing. So we are in the same situation. You have F bounded to the left, strongly rigid on this S. But here, so instead of taking formally saturated polytrail, I just take a general one. So then, and this could be really something very nice. For instance, the spectrum of evaluation ring in some finitely generated extension of your base. Okay, so in this case, we have the following. So there are two properties, which somehow essentially gives a way to compute the CH cohomology of B with value in F. Okay, so the first property is the following. So this is in the case if B has lengths one or smaller than one, this, then the following square correctly. So, so it's R gamma psi h of V tilde minus sigma V. So V tilde is again this the same thing as here. You complete and then you, you want to argue this idea by the idea of the two evaluation. And then, so this is in the case where the height is 1. Then in general, we have this. So let G inside D be an open subset, and Z inside D be a closed subset. And assume that they intersect. Right, so in particular, D and Z are non-empty, and therefore they are also positive for them. Then the following square is correct. Well, let me say it already. Why this is really as good as really completing the cohomology of it. So, in some sense, this statement reduces the. So if you want to understand this group here or this complex, you can. It's enough somehow to understand the values of f at algebraically closed fields. So why is this the case? So what you can argue by induction on the lens of V, and so this somehow this kind of square says that it's enough to understand the values of the cohomology of V when V has lens 1. Okay? Because you can by induction you can reduce to a lens 1 thing. Okay? So if you argue by induction, then you can assume that this is a field. This is somehow then this you understand that this has lens less than V. So you are limited to the case where the lens is 1, but here then you can use A, which tells you that to understand this group, it's enough to understand these three groups. Now, this and this is our cohomology of fields again, and these are points. But this also, this is a formally saturated polytree, right? So its value is also the value of the residue field. So you are done.
Okay. Excuse me. In D, yeah. We are supposing that D and Z cover B.
Yeah. Oh, I mean they do because this is open, this is closed, they intersect.
Ah yes.
They cover.
Yeah. Exactly.
Okay. So let me sketch the proof of this theorem. In fact, so what happens is that the proof of the second theorem is exactly the same as the proof of the first theorem, except that you need to know the first theorem. Okay, so I will only prove the first theorem and then tell you that the proof is the same. You just have to, So the first theorem is proven by induction on the by induction on the formal dimension of W. But once the theorem 1 is proven, then you can repeat the same proof using this theorem to prove A and B. It will become clearer then later, I think. the proof of theorem 1 will be will have two parts. The first part will be supremely constrained set like this, and the second part will be supremely constrained like this. So we can assume, of course, assume F to be stage 5, right? So in this case, we need to show that F U mapping to my U was it. And as I said, so we argue. So there will be two parts. So and part A is the case. So here we assume that the length of the open subset is equal to this. So of course, the length zero case is empty. There's nothing. So take length equal to 1. And of course, also if U is equal to W, also there's nothing to prove. Okay, so we can assume that U is, so we assume that U is distinct. Okay, and so what we do, we consider the following, so we consider there is no reason for this to be like this, so this could be a priori very ugly. Okay, so, but, and so, and on the other hand, we can also look at the following square. That F two is some of the. And so I'll this later, but so now let's assume that this is the case and see how we can conclude. So of course, we know that you know f square 1 is multiplied by Cartesian. This is because f is fiber. This is a kind of a distinguished square. And so, putting these two together, we see that f delta 3, where of course delta 3 is probably 2, 1. You put these two together. Then you have to have a common line here. And delta 3 is a composition. So this is how to pick up this. So we have this line and this line. Now, what we want to do? We want to show that. Then you see this going to here. This induces a quasi isomorphism on F because of property two of strong rigidity. Right? Remember, in the definition of strong rigidity, I have two conditions. One which is the natural one. We want the value of the closed point being the value of the whole thing. And then there was a second one, which is here. But this is exactly saying that if I look at f of this and f of this, they are quasi-isomorphic. And this is a generic point of u, and this is a generic point of u theta. Okay, and by definition, they are quasi-isomorphic. And therefore, since this gives me homotopy Cartesian square, we deduce that the value f on here is quasi-isomorphic to f on u. But now f of u theta, this is u theta is formally saturated. So the value of f at u theta, this is at the value of the points. And this gives what you want. Okay? So we are left to check that this thing is true, that this square is homotopy. So we are left. And to do this, we apply this refined. Again, remind you. So, of course, in the general side, if you want to check that the complex is eccentric, you can just look at the points. But I skipped the proof of of a version of this which is somehow refined, and it, but it, so it concerned the acyclicity of the cohomology of one object, but it gave me somehow some control about the points that I need to check for which this compounds vanish. Okay, do you see what I'm speaking about? Do you remember the statement that I? This is the proposition that has two parts, A and B, and part A was about two sections over some pro object U and so on. Okay, so this is the one that I need to use here. So the idea is that you can rewrite this condition as a specificity of one particular complex, and then you are reduced to check that the base change of this square, so this is over U, for some W, which is a formally separated, not W, T. For some T formally separated, mapping to U, and the important thing here is that it has plus formal dimension less than n minus 1. And this is a crucial thing here, is that since U is a strict open subset of W, it can be written as a limit of a pro scheme having a crude dimension n minus 1. And then I can assume, I only need to check this property for T mapping to U with formal dimension n minus 1. And therefore, I can use now the induction hypothesis to do something. Okay? All right, so let's maybe try to finish this argument. See, this square delta 2 consists of essentially of an open immersion and a closed immersion. So when I pull back to T, I will still have everywhere. So I will still have a square of polyfill. So let me write down the square like this. So let me maybe give some notation. So let T prime be T times. It's over U hat, of course. So, U is already. So the base of the square is U hat, sorry, I'm up to you. So T prime would be this. T double prime would be this. Okay, so we have two closed subs. And so the square that the base change of the square becomes the following one. So we have T. And here we have T minus P double prime. So this is the square. So this is a formally separated. And so this is a closed polyhedron, and these are open, if they are non-empty, of course. Okay. So if everything would be non-empty, then this thing becomes clear now, because just by induction. So the value here and here is the same, because these are two saturated polyhedrons that they have. So and the value of f on them is the value on the residue field, and the residue field is the same. If these two are also non-empty, then also they have the same residue field. This is T double prime, this is T prime, this is T. So if I remove T double prime, I still have the same as B. there a problem in the notation? So this is the smallest one, and yeah, we are dealing with finite ordered set. So if these two things are not empty, then they have the same residue field, and by induction, I know that the value of f is the value of the residue field. So then it will be not. So this will be isomorphic. So the only thing to check is that this can never be empty. Okay, and this is exactly this condition. This is this proposition I stated today. So when you have so we have this. We have u hat, and we are mapping to u hat some polytrich. So of course, the only case that we need to consider is when sigma t hits the closed point, and maybe eta t does not go to the closed point. So this is the only case which is non-trivial. But in this case, we know that then the image of t contains also u tilde. Yeah? And then it's ensured that this guy here is non-empty. So maybe I skip part two because it's really quite similar, or part two or two.
It's really the same story essentially. Let's skip it.
Okay, so it's so we come to another painful paragraph also, which is. This is an extension of what I said today, extension to this class. And of course, it's clear why I need some extension, because see, the last step that we were, where we were, was somehow involved computing the cohomology or involve some complex of species on scalar schemes. Remember, scalar schemes, this is given by a morphism of scheme. It's just a morphism of scheme. And so we need to define, redefine one, the PCH topology, we prove this kind of result in the context of scalar schemes. So I just tried to give you this in a quick way. So there are some things that are maybe slightly subtle. But yeah. All right. So let me quickly just make a percent. What is the H? The H star topology. Schemes is generated by two kinds of covers. So families. Such that if I look at F1i, so this will be a family going to X1, I want this to be an H cover of X1. And I also want the condition on the other maps, and I want the maps Fi0 to be first kind of cover, so it's essentially an H cover of X1, and I want the maps F0 to be very close to finite fiber. And then the second kind of maps, I want families again like this. So here I ask the FIs to be Cartesian. Right, okay, you see what I mean? So each FI is really a square, and I want the square to be Cartesian. Okay, Cartesian, and then I ask the family F0i. The HH starter book. And okay, as usual, this also makes sense. This might sound a bit weird. Maybe let me just make a remark to explain why this is somehow natural to ask for these maps. Here's a remark. So you could ask, what are the points? Not what is the point, but what are the points of this topology? Say any maybe on finite type scheme. So what are the points of these? And the answer, so this is an exercise. Okay? Answer is that these are given by so-called star, which is what? So this is something given by star, which it consisting. Generically, So differently, the generic field, the field of fraction, is algebraically closed in the field of fraction. Okay. So these are the points of this proposal. I think these are natural things to consider. I mean, you don't want to consider more general morphism of quality. I mean, you don't want the point going to something large. So these are somehow like a nice class of star quality, and then these are really the point of this.
Okay, so
I need some notation to define the psi version of this. So let's see, take x star to be an affine star squared. Okay, so there are two cases. Let's say case one, we take z inside x0, a closed subset, so a closed constructible. So then when I write x star minus z, this is really the map x1 minus x1 times x0, z going to z. And when I write x hat star at z, this is really the map. The completion of x1 at x1, x0, x0, x0. Okay, so this is the first case. Second case is when you take z inside x1, then if I write x star minus z, this is really x1 minus z dot x0. Right, so with this make just definition, so the CHH star topology on, let's just do it on X. So generated by first HH star covers. Second, these are this kind of maps, the usual one, the deep squares. Right, with the notation as well. And then the third one, which is not very important. In this case, you don't even need. So I already said what was a star polytrace. So we we can also define the notion of formally saturated grids. There are some definitions. So just to make things precise, so formally local star collision, a star, this is just a map of formally local things, which we assume to be, which is, we assume that this map is dominantly local. And then we have the definition of formally saturated or pre-saturated star. What do you say? The same thing, so it's just a map, which we assume to be local. Okay, so I just state that this theorem that I said is out of star, or maybe I should not do this, I don't know. I should still, yeah, I should maybe define it. Say that F on X is standard rigid. If for all W star, which is formally separated, we have a solution that F W star sigma W star. Of course, sigma W star makes sense because the map is local, so it does make sense to be called sigma W star. If I take U star inside W star such that the length of U1 is equal to this time 1, which implies that the length of U0 is also less than 1, then you want that F star, which also makes sense, is the same as eta U star. This is a definition of being smoothly rigid, and then we have the same, exactly the same sort of. This is what I wanted to say about this star version. Let's now try to move on it. Should we maybe take a break?
Because of the colloquium.
When should I stop? Is it at 5 or? No, no, this is 4.
So okay, okay. Say in 60 minutes we should.
In 60 minutes, yeah. Okay, so let's take 10 minutes of break. Okay? And I need to. So the next paragraph is about essentially the property of strong rigidity. The last step we have to. So let me remind you what so so we so the essentially one that is context of fishing wide out. So we have constructed over some diagram of soft variation. This was by Pistor. So diagram the theory is by Pistor over line omega n. Okay, so and so how to and so some of the goals would be to essentially to prove that this guy is strong dimension. So to do this, I need to remind you about how this was constructed. All right, so for, let's fix the index. Let x star I up. Okay, excellent. And then we can associate with this data the following diagram. So here is the projection. Here we are over P star, but P star, let me remind you, is simply given by a product of E over line with some power alpha over A. We have seen this many times. Okay, and then with this solution, we can associate the canonical map of X to E alpha 0. So essentially, E alpha 0 is one of the largest quotient of alpha for which the mark factors through the open subset E alpha 0. And furthermore, on here we have this, we have a natural module with integral connection that I think I so this lives in meek of logarithmic type. And so and in this situation we associate first object of again a vector type over STU. And this was defined as you you pull back by Rx. Then you project and everything is non-derived, just essentially global section which are constant relative to the spot. And then you pick up the largest logarithmic type somewhat. So this is so of course, by this I mean that whenever you restrict to one of the indices, okay. So I'll try to say a couple of words about the proof. This is. There are two things to check. So we fix select W of E formally So what do we need to check? So there are two properties. So let's start by the first one. So what we need to do is I need to show that y dot w is going to sigma w. This W is a limit of formally local conditions, which I can even assume to be regular, so which we can be assumed. Of course, using resolution of singularities, right? since this is a after the singularities, and you get something regular. And so then what you are left to check is to check something like this. So you have y dot so then we can assume that so we have to check that. There's a couple of stars everywhere. So. So we are left to check the same thing, but now for a formally local regular condition. Now star. Now is Okay, so essentially at 0 and 1, this is given by essentially a formal power series at some points. However, the map could be anything. The map is not necessarily, the map from V1 to V0 is not necessarily nice. It could be any map. Okay, now so the thing that we want, I mean this isomorphism somehow followed quite easily from the following two facts. Well, the first fact is that the functor from modulus connection of the right wing type on V1 or V0 mapping to the same thing. These two facts are kind of clear and easy. I hope you agree with me. This is actually true for more generally for holonomic models, holonomic which are smooth. So when you don't have similarities, this is an improvement. So in particular, it preserves the very big. So this is, of course, this is used to check that. So this implies that y at g star restricted to sigma. Restricted to sigma d zero is the same. Since the way these are constructed is via some adjoint functions, so you put back, bring down, and since we have these equivalence of categories, these two functions do the same, either we use V star or we use sigma V star. Okay, so this gives us this value. Then the next thing is now clear. I mean, so then this does this give us what we want, maybe that. And this is because these are also orthogonal types, so they are extension of trivial modules. And for trivial modules, we have the Durand cohomology is computed by the Durand complex, and we know that they are quasi-isomorphic. Okay. So this is how one gets the first one. Okay. Now the second part is slightly more complicated. So let me sketch arguments. So here. Notation. So we have U star inside U star, just translates one, so the sets of. And we complete this tag, and then we pass to this closed scheme in the filter. And what we want to do here is to, so the goal is to, again, we want to show that you dot at eta star equivalent. And in fact, it's easy to convince yourself that this would follow by the same reasoning if we have the analogous properties of these processes. Okay, so, second is that the drum complex includes also the drum homology of beta. We have these two things and we are done. So, and in fact, it turns out that we only need to check the second condition. So, two implies one. So I will not really tell you exactly how, but just roughly speaking, so. If you want, I mean, let's just do the simpler case where we assume that at least at sigma w has no has a discrete foliation. There's nothing coming from sigma w. So then in this case, one can essentially, so one can use the fact that the fundamental group of same for okay, so using something like this one can reduce to just checking second property. And so second property we, and again I just assume this hypothesis for simplicity. So the second property is really is not so difficult. It's really but essentially computation. So there is the following easy step. So first one show one show the following. So let's take v equal to just for simplicity, just take this. And then invert T1 Tn. Okay, so let's maybe give let's call this one. Okay. Then it's really an exercise to show that the Dirac homology is just simply exterior algebra on. Okay, so this is a residue map as well. It's very simple. Now, now the point is that u, or even let's just take eta of w. So I mean, this is really the main point. That when you so of course if you look at eta x, this is very complicated, but if you take a formally saturated poetry and then you look at the generic point of this, then this can be written as a limit of things like that. And this is again a resolution of singularity. You take one of these WIs and you take an open subset in it. That's what it is, right? Then you can resolve similarities and assume that this is a complement of a normal crossing divide. And then you complete there, and then you get something like this. Okay? And so since you can do this, then this tells you that in fact the Dirac homology of eta of w, you can write it maybe in an essentially canonical way as the serial algebra of I think the this guy. The value group tensors. Okay? And so you use this formula twice, here and for the residue field, and then for eta w, and then essentially this gives you what you want. Okay. This is us. I think I won't say more about this. So we still need one thing also, another example of a formally rigid species. See immediately why. Yes, we need this. So, further that point remark, if you look at, I mean, of course, we also we need also to know that O star is strongly rigid because also O star appears in this spectrum that get the map from omega. But in fact, it turns out, I mean, it's clear that this is not strongly rigid. Obvious reason, because if you look at O star of omega, this is really much bigger than O star of O star is not strongly rigid. But it turns out that you can modify this in a minimal way, and it works. So we define by setting this, so which we see that full star one.
Okay.
This is the co-kernel of all direct sum over all maps of position from X to spectrum K. Double parenthesis T, one parenthesis is enough. And you direct sum by some of the following groups, 1 plus T. So of course this is a group of subgroup of units of generated by 1 plus t is a unit here, and this is a subgroup by this unit. For every such map, you get a group, you get the morphism from this group to OX, sending 1 plus t to 1 plus f. A unique such morphism. I mean, unique.
T now is not a parameter like you choose, it's just one variable, right?
Yeah, I don't know. What
like, I mean, before we were
T is fixed if you want. You can fix it.
Yeah, it's just one variable, not
T1,
T1.
T is one variable, yeah. Okay. And we fix T, we let F vary, and the maps sends 1 plus T to 1 plus T. For my T structure. Okay, this is we completed. This is the group O star X mod out by invertible function 1 plus f for every map from X to this.
Okay.
All right. So here are some facts. Proof. I think so. First, we have O star of X dot parenthesis. Second is that if X is a finite type scheme, then you really don't change anything.
It's the same as
well. This is clear because there are no maps. I mean, every map from this finite type scheme to such a guy would factor through the closed one. And here's the proposition that what's our bar is from here. Which is not surprising since we have the first condition that follows immediately from this part. And so this is.
Okay.
Let me finish quickly now. The lecture as follows. So let me remind you, we have this R star applied to R gene stage R star. sigma in tilde 1. This is some complex of P-sheet on excellent collision over a field. It's actually a diagram of such things, right? And then from this we obtain the spectrum that we which receives the map from Omega. But so how this clearly goes to the following thing. So of course you can this goes to pi over star, p over star of sigma t tilde. And then instead of making CV stage fibrate, and then you can just make it make one step and then go even make it CH star fibrate. So if you make this fibrate for the CH topology, you apply P and then this is of course nothing from there. Okay, because I mean the idea is important that this is finer than this, and moreover, P lower star of this is still at least CH vibrant, which is also finer than B C double. Okay. Okay. Sorry. Is there something? Is there something missing? Okay, so we have this, and then we can even do better. We can, we can go further and put a sigma here, a bar here, and of course this is sigma bar. This is instead of taking O star, you are taking O bar star. Different suspension spectrum, but where you use OSTAR. Here we're using OSTAR. Okay, so we have this. Now now we are in the situation. So this guy here is from the region. And you are computing essentially CH star cohomology of this guy. And so we can use what we know, I mean what we've learned today, to see if we can do something. And in fact, we can do something, and we can do the following. So now this trick is the schemes of finite types. So we restrict this D spectrum to finite type scheme. And so of course we try to compute what we get. And so we look at this. We look at this locally for the H topology. Okay, so here, on finite time scheme, there's no CH topology, there's only the H topology. So we look at this object locally for the H topology, which means that we are looking at the values of this T spectrum at poly 3, which are general, which are nice in the sense that they are given by valuation ring in some finite transcendence extension of the T. Okay, so we try to compute this gadget here. At some geometric, if you want, some geometric polytree. Okay, and we do this by we compute this using the previous theorem. And as I explained to you, the previous theorem somehow reduces the computation of such cohomology group to the knowledge of the complex of P-sheets at some specific fields. And it turns out that the fields that you get are also geometric fields. So there are finite extension, finite type extension of the base field. So in some sense we get something which depends only on geometric data, right? And so Next time I will somehow get this idea more precise and tell you exactly how we what we get and how we get something that can be described completely using standard algebraic geometry language. So I think this will be for next time, and I think I stop.